Yes.
Okay, so would you like to give a bill on like the research, the development plan that you can come up with?
What was your?
Okay, so yeah, so we had facilities management. And.
FEMA.
I'm sorry, we're here.
Yeah, please don't.
So we have facilities management, and we talked a little bit about sort of the integral role that that plays in WCDC, right? So when we think facilities management, what it is sort of renovation, construction, expansion, getting the materials, taking care of sort of those internal things. But we sort of overlook how important that is, not just to us as having like a physical building, right? Because it's important to have a structurally sound building that doesn't fall apart, all that stuff. But it plays such a huge role in bringing in new prospects and getting that buy-in that we've been talking about. If we serve 158 kids, and each of them has two people that are close to them, right? We said that's 316 people who will be in contact with that building. If that building doesn't look good, smell good, feel good, we're losing those people. So despite all the things that we do to be the cornerstone of Woodbury, if I walk into a building that doesn't smell the greatest, they're like, oh, it must not be that great because it's sort of, it's not that good, right? So two things that we talked about was, A, getting the materials together, and Carol did a really great job of like sort of summarizing that for us. So finding, being able to find materials that we can renovate with, finding contractors, finding those people, and trying to keep it at a low cost because like money makes the world go around. But also, another key element to it is we need to be, I hate saying selling because this is nonprofit, but selling the idea that we're building. We're not just restoring, we're building. And so that's getting the roof repaired and patched up, or maybe even replacing a whole roof. What we're saying is that we're going in this direction. We're going up here. And what we've been able to create, even with three patches in the roof, has already been great. So imagine what we can do with a whole roof that doesn't leak. Imagine what we can do if you can walk into an office and it smells like, I don't know, apple cinnamon glade, rather than rain. Imagine what you can do with a building that has a flat screen TV with everybody's faces on it. That you have a 5-year-old child who feels like a movie star because their face is on the front of a nice building. Imagine what that means for a parent who sees their kid and, you know, from day to day they may be working 2 or 3 or 4 jobs, right? And they're struggling. But they can walk into that building and see their child recognized in a way that they couldn't do that for themselves. And that's what facilities management means to WCDC. And if we can focus on that and show that we're expanding and that we're giving these children what they need, and not only what they need, but what they deserve, we can get the buy-in on a level that we haven't had quite yet. So that's a little bit of what we're talking about.
Here at the back table, we had some phenomenal ideas here. Great minds working together. Community development was our role here. And what we feel one of the most important things is with our community development plan for the Child and Development Center is, first of all, starting with an extremely high ideal. And we already have one in place. Dr. L already put it there. Morality. And one of the most important things with the need of morality for our children and building our children up is having the whole community putting that energy and that morality to build that morality effort into our children. So with our community development plan, we thought that first we should start with that high ideal, morality. Then we assess, do an assessment of the things that we have. We know that we have in our community, we have leadership, we have pillars of leadership in our community with the church. We know we have business, government, church business, government, other community leaders as well, things like the child development, things like the Woodbury Boys and Girls Club. And we can leverage the abilities of those leaders and leverage the qualities that they have and try to utilize those things to help to implement some of the things that they've learned in building themselves up, how we can teach that to the children, how we can use those qualities that they have to teach them to the children to help them build the children up. Implementing strategies that we can use to show children by allowing them to achieve, by helping them to achieve and gain small wins, showing them that they can actually build this belief in themselves, which they only do by getting those small wins. Once they start to win, they start to learn, they start to see that they can do these things. Now they have that faith and it kind of strengthens their belief in them. So once we can help to do that, but there was a question, I apologize. Once we can do that and build up that belief in them, we can help to push them more into a positive direction, closer to that morality that we want to try to get them to. Also, after we have assessed what we have and developed a strategic plan, now we can start to implement the things that we have learned using all of our pillars in our community. And then once we have implemented those things, now we can do a reassessment of what we have. So once they start to learn those things, they start to implement them, we see what they're doing with it, see how we can, our new assessment can see how we can strengthen those abilities that they have. And now extract from what they've done, try to retailer it, maybe redesign it if necessary, or restructure it, and continue to push them in more of a positive direction. And lastly, I actually forgot the last thing. I wish I could kind of, you might want to check my notes real quick. The last thing I wanted to do.
You're giving them knowledge and wisdom that they can interact and move into the community. So the idea that was shared was, through life experience, we can give a holistic form of education and professional development, varying in even in pulling and in implementing some of the everyday to-dos, bringing that down to the teacher level, the staff level, so that they can learn more about the systems. And we've talked about how we have to study because not everything's given to us, so we can study what we need to implement certain things, and then also and professionally develop informally but formally at the same time. The other idea is pulling in the concept of vision. So we believe as a group that the education is about from starts at birth and it goes to whatever, and for everyone as an entity, the Child Development Center has a vision, and that vision is built on. But if we utilize that concept and some of the concepts that build this awesome board at all levels, so at the level of the staff, each staff member should have their own personal vision. Each teacher should have their own personal vision for their classroom and what that entails. Each child should have a vision. If they can't vision it, then we shall vision it for them until they're capable, which would guide them to that point. So if we're all working with that perspective and then working for the whole, then we can really move things forward. And the third perspective on education and professional development is that there is a spirit that we all move with. So when we to implement the vision, we have to understand who we are, what we really want. Even those who are in life and moving on, and they did this and this, they played all their cards right, and they got everything they need. They think they're doing what society wants them to do, but they're still kind of missing something. For me, it's like, it's a core value. It's a core, who are you at the core? And can you find peace in that space so that you can open yourself up to what's really possible for you and find the words and the wisdom to believe what's possible for you and integrate that into who you are and then unfold educationally and professionally.
Okay, lastly, we're going to explain resource development. I'm going to start off with definitions, give examples, bullet points, and then examples, okay? So resource development is a source of a supply, support, or aid that can be easily or readily drawn upon, okay? It is to help fund the vision of the organization to improve it and make it better. The 4 points I have here that will help develop the vision, make it better, and improve it, especially over the Child Development Center. The resources that are needed are capital. Capital meaning money, also meaning whoever can invest into the organization, whether it be through donations or any type of monetary contributions. So that is needed in order to develop the organization. Second one would be labor. People, people, people. I don't care what any organization you have, they want your time and your money, okay? So just like anything, in order to improve, we need labor, we need individuals, and we need their time, okay? So we need to grow up. So labor. The third one is entrepreneur ability. We need individuals that are skilled. Okay, they have expertise, they have visions that are innovative, okay? And those particular individuals will help move the organization forward, make it better, and take it to the next level. The last one would be the physical land or building. Improving on it, developing, and taking it to match the vision. So all these resources, whether it be money, capital, special skills, or the land, where Child Development Center has to tap into it. So right now they're tapping into it with us. Okay. As far as volunteers, we are the labor, the parents, okay, and anybody else we can find, the community, so forth and so on. So we have to use every resource that we have in this township. Small businesses, the parents, the churches. Anyone that wants to come and help to move the vision forward. So those were the 4 main points of resources, and that can be put underneath there.
I have to make you aware of what just happened, because I see this so many times. You have to understand, you had a short period of time to do what you just did. Be able to do that, digest the information, and then have to pull somebody out on the spot to present is what they call peak performance. Now, the deal with that is you want to train yourself to be at that level all the time and become second nature to you, to do that. And money rolls, and money's not an issue anymore because people are looking at that and you have value. You have value that they can't buy, and that's the way it works. So we have a great group here. Let's do that in a short period of time. That was 4 different ideas in the same time frame, and you performed. We're going to have these guys come up, but I do have a couple of announcements. There are more people that were supposed to be here today, so that we can build upon what you just said. Dr. Lynn Burnham is actually a professor of psychology at Widener. He's a former NFL player, and he's also the VP of the NFL Alumni Association Philadelphia chapter. He texted me that he had some issues, so he wouldn't be here today. Now, he's not coming on the board, but he has vowed to represent our vision, what we're trying to do. And we have other people like that, Sheridan Cisco, who's Sheridan Scholarship Foundation. She's actually got kind of training today, along with Christina Rodriguez, who does a bunch of stuff. She does. She's actually one of our internet advanced media iron news group people. She couldn't be here today, it's her birthday. And the other one I want to speak for is Ben Carroll. Ben Carroll is just a great individual. He's an IT specialist, entrepreneur, developed his business on his own by himself. He got sick yesterday. He said he would be better, he'd come, but not. And it's important, the ones that I mentioned are important because they really do represent as individuals and have for the longest time that I know. They're just strong individuals. And I specifically like to acknowledge the gentlemen here because all of the gentlemen in this room, I can walk away and not be concerned about what they're going to say, thank you, feel or do. I mean, they're just strong characters, integrity, the whole bit, every last one of them. And we have more of those to come. And that's important because we need these folks, us folks, need to be in front of our young men and women, teenagers, because they don't see us. We don't hear our corners. But, no, they didn't see that. So I'm really kind of happy that they were here and they all, you know, we work together. So that's a good thing. Ron's going to come up. Ron is our certified fundraiser specialist, guru of business development.
The agenda says fundraising. If you want to stay here for another hour and a half, I can get you started. And neither do I.
Your time is just for shrunken down to like 10 minutes. I know.
But what I want to do is to just start you on a couple of things, and you'll see that it does fit with fundraising. Before that, just a couple of things more on me. You already heard where I've worked. I retired from the Boy Scouts of America in South Jersey February 1st, 7 years ago. Moved to Delaware. One of the first things I did when I moved to Delaware is I joined the Central Delaware Chamber of Commerce. Went to my first networking mixer meeting, was walking around and introduced myself to a gentleman, said I was retired. The gentleman looked at me and said, if you're retired, what are you doing with the Chamber of Commerce? And my comment to him was, I've retired from business, but I haven't retired from life. You know, we never stop learning. We never stop getting involved. I was the volunteer marketing chair for the Chamber for 3 years, was on their committee for 4 years. I'm now an ambassador and deal with new companies that are coming on. Chamber has over 1,000 companies in the Chamber. I'm the 5K chair for the Central Delaware Habitat for Humanity, and I'm on the grant committee for an LGBT community center in Rehoboth. So I'm involved in the community, and always have been. So I want to do a couple things with you, and he's coming down from an hour and a half to an hour. Take two stickies.
Just lost 2 more minutes.
I hear you. Take two stickies and then pass them on. And you guys got your stickies up here.
Oh,
yeah. Here's what I want you to do. Just take a minute, and I just want you to write on one of the stickies. What are you most proud about with the Development Center? Or why are you here on the board? And don't say, Stanley, you invited me.
No, don't.
What's your warm fuzzy of why you're involved with the Development Center?
You're getting too much time. You gave them too much time.
See my stopwatch up here? I'm watching it. Should be an easy one, should be quick. If it's tough, So let's start over here on the left. Read off your sticky and then bring it up and put it up front. Go ahead.
Okay, so I'm proud to be
Woodbury CDC board member, and what I'm most proud of is I really enjoy to hear the smiles and the laughter of the children when I come into the building. I love to see that they enjoy their day.
Okay, just put it up there. Go ahead.
What I like about Woodbury Child Development Center is that the faculty members really have a passion about helping the kids.
Okay.
I like school board because I know that I can help. I have a lot of different hats that I wear, so I can see the bigger picture, and I like being that my child was there, so I get them as a parent and as a board leader, so I hope you're kind of seeing that picture.
I read three things. The reason I enjoy being here is the strength of the board and their vision. There's community-based organization and the family focus.
Okay.
The center seems to ID the problems that we have in society and will and wants to change that condition.
Okay.
I just had that one thing for our mom on the board.
Bring it up front. That's okay. You want to be on the board. Maybe you're all proud.
Commitment to growing and developing children and their knowledge, confidence, and
ability. Okay.
Just because I left the message, permission, I'm invested in the vision and I believe in the power of writing.
Okay.
What I'm most proud about is that my daughter is the director and I want to support her vision. I'm passionate about children and education. I want to be involved in my community and I want to be part of this village.
Bless you. The back, go ahead.
I am here and are most proud of. I simply believe that investing in our young people's talents, beliefs, and potential promises a great lifelong return to citizenship and contributions to our society.
Okay.
I'm impressed with the history, the commitment to our youth through passionate volunteering, giving of oneself and resources, and belief of achieving greatness within them.
Okay. Go ahead. Anybody else? Okay. Up front.
Our ability to service a diverse population of low-income families.
After 48 years, we are still in business to service children with a learning atmosphere.
Okay.
Pretty much the same. It serves one of the most vital segments of the community and capital letters children.
Cool. What do you write? What are you most proud of?
Yeah, you had to write it down, too.
Yeah,
we
should. Why?
I just
let you
write the
front. Go ahead.
The family concept of Woodbury Child Development Center.
Why would you think of
it? Go ahead.
I'm most proud of the potential of realizing the vision we have for the children that face one.
Okay, cool. Okay, secondly. You're about to get in an elevator, you're in there with another person, you got 2 floors, 20 seconds, and the person asks you, what's the Child Development Center all about? Now, before you write it, you don't have to tell them everything that's happening here. Think of what you just said. All you want to do is pique their interest and get them thinking so that they may ask you more questions later on or want to sit down with you again. So if you've got 20 seconds and somebody asks you, what's the Child Development Center all about? What are you going to tell them? Write it on your other sticky.
You want me to write down the time?
Yeah.
I can tell you right
now.
Can you repeat that one more time?
Okay, you got somebody asked you, what is the Child Development Center about? You got 20 seconds. You're certainly not going to read off the mission. What are you going to tell them to pique their interest? And again, remember what you're most proud of, because that will help get you started.
Thank you, Dan.
You don't like me moving around, do you? Okay, you don't have to bring it up. Hold on, because you may need it again later. Go ahead.
We have safe, affordable child care while you can work. We have great hours and great meals.
Anybody else?
She just got it. Okay. Just to piggyback off their education for the youth at an affordable cost.
A place to develop lifelong skills through education, being a more example to the kids there, and enable them to thrive in their future world.
Okay.
And then educational setting for children 4 months to 5 years, with the goal of helping them realize their full potential and achieve it academically, socially, and more.
Okay. Okay, that's fine. That's okay. Anybody else?
To improve the now, to excel in the future.
There you go.
Oh, wonderful. Yeah, I did.
Well,
activating youth potential to leveraging the strengths of our community.
Okay.
Developing, encouraging, and growing our future.
Cool.
I just with teaching children how to learn a full of like different. Because when we were coming up, you didn't have anybody there saying, you could do this, you could be an astronaut, you could do this. Mm-hmm. And we want to put all those out there so that, you know, there's a lot of different activities to do it, different ways to be leaders.
Okay. In the back.
Developing a high level of excellence in our children, instilling morality, ethics, and a sense of brilliance in our youth through academic improvement, development, and achievement.
Okay.
And improving our community through the building of morals and characters in young children.
Woodbury Child Development is a cornerstone of our community, and what we hope to do is be a model throughout the country, because we focus on morale, on morals, ethics, and sound principles. That's what I tell people now. Anyway.
Anybody else on Friday?
Just having a nurturing atmosphere while watching your children.
Okay.
You guys pretty much said everything, huh?
Yeah, no excuse. That's all you have. That is no excuse for you.
Serve children, but as a community building organization.
Okay. So you first started with, what are you most proud of? You know, and that can be used to bring out the excitement in your 22nd elevator speech. In your folder is this piece of paper. You pull it out. It's not going anywhere, it's staying with you. Take 2 minutes to get it started. And see if you can fill in any of those blanks. Who's your dentist? The last person to recruit you. Take 2 minutes to get it started. We're not going to wait for everybody to just finish the whole thing. Okay, you can keep writing. You're gonna hold on to those. You're not gonna turn those in. But so, the heading of why I was up here was fundraising. So let's just review what we did. What was your passion? Why are you here? What would I say if I had 20 seconds to talk to somebody about Child Development Center? And you just put together a prospect list of people you know. That using your passion and using your 22nd elevator speech, you could go talk to about the development center, whether it be volunteering, whether it be raising money. When I worked for the Boy Scouts of America in South Jersey, I did 7 events. I'll move this. I did 7 fundraising events a year. 2 were golf tournaments, raised a couple $100,000. We had a popcorn sale, raised over $100,000. Had corporate giving, and individual giving was, I don't know, like $500,000, $250,000, I don't remember now, it's been 7 years. But the most important fundraising I did was individuals. Because individuals, when they start giving and they're passionate about who they're giving to, are going to continue to give every year. Where corporations, it depends on their budget. I used to golf tournaments. Banks used to be big for golf tournaments, and then, you know, budgets got cut. I used to, in every county in South Jersey, run a fundraising event in honor of a distinguished citizen in the community. And depending on who that person was he attended. So, in my opinion, the thing you want to do to build your base of fundraising is individuals. So that's, any quick questions? More than willing to come back another time and spend a little bit more time to talk about board fundraising.
Yeah. Right on the line.
Good job. You want me to reset it?
Yeah. Okay, let me start with a quick story. I have 33 years of experience with working for or on or managing something from the federal government. Educated here in the state, attended Township, graduated from that high school, went on to Rutgers University, and got a bachelor's in science and sociology and a bachelor's art in urban and regional planning. I went on to work for a private nonprofit, and then that 1 year, and I went on to work for Essex County in the transportation planning industry. Went from the county to an organization that was managing counties and the program, and then I went from there to the federal government. Started with the U.S. Department of Transportation, Federal Highway Administration, was there for 3 years, went on and went to, in 1999, went to the Department of Commerce, Economic Development Administration, and managed programs. Now those two federal departments deal with federal aid very differently, but the two experiences gave me both sides of what I was doing already before I became a federal employee, and that is managing money, managing awards to do either economic development planning and building or transportation planning and or highway and bridge building. I right now manage the entire state's non-construction program, with the exception of operations. Right now in the news, you may have heard about the Turnpike Bridge. That is all being coordinated through my office as well as the Pennsylvania Division because it spans to Delaware. But the reason why I raise that to you and give you my experience is because all of that in my career in the federal service, or outside, I've been an entrepreneur. I helped my brother start a company many years ago. He's in IT. There's 3 brothers. I'm the only one that's public servant. They're both in the private sector. My older brother, IT, system architecture. My younger brother, break fix guy. He's now doing IT recruiting for Amazon. I talk about all that because on both sides of the ledger, there's something called internal controls. No matter whether I told you about the different types of organizations based on the IRS code. You're either one of these things under those codes. There's never a time not to have business practices even when you're a nonprofit because you're subject to the same thing when we talk about audits. Everybody know what audit is? They come in and examine the fiscal integrity of your books. And it doesn't matter whether it's an individual, whether it's a for-profit corporation or non-profit corporation, the rules are still the same.
And so the only way that you're going to have any integrity is one, that your board has the integrity to carry out those rules, and the individuals that are responsible, either earning a salary or you're earning an income as a private corporation. So you're always responsible for managing the money. The federal government in earnest started a process under the president to take five rules, leave one of them separate. It's called federal acquisition rules, which is, it governs contracting from the government to the private sector directly. That's FRA. Then there are four other rules: nonprofits, hospitals, universities, state and local government. They took those rules and they melted them down. They melted them down to streamline the examination of carrying out the funding principles. All of that examination is required to have some kind of internal controls. The other thing is they introduced something called performance management. So now you are no longer just going to be examined for how well you keep your books. You're now saying you spent this amount of money, does it equate to the outcome that you desired when you applied for that money? And did you do it in an efficient manner? And could you have done it better? So they marry performance. You're probably going to start seeing, you may not see under this new administration, what I call program auditors. They're not going to be CPAs that show up. It's people that really know their business. Somebody like myself, I can do program audit. And I am responsible to make sure that program audits are done because of what happened in at the Office of Management and Budget. So, with all that said, it still means that there's internal controls. So, and if I was going to do a program audit of this nonprofit, one of the things that has to be measured is, do you have your information documented? All your procedures should be documented. How you deal with your volunteers, how you deal with your former employees, how the board conducts its business, how they hire people, what salaries and why. Do you not understand your marketplace? And do you understand your role and your mission in that geography? Because it can be very different. If this nonprofit was in Philadelphia, it may have a different kind of role and attachment to the community, and that would govern what kind of internal controls are required. Okay, so it's important that the information that you have, whatever you come up with, first you have a vision, right? And then you should have a documented, at least about your process. Stan and I had the fortunate ability to dictate an organization early on when it first started. Now, at the time, they received state money, but most of the people around the table had never been in an organization. So we actually developed the board. And one of the things that we made sure they understood is Robin Rules of Order. As the board, every decision that you make, particularly ones that are financial, should be documented. Why am I saying that? Because if I come in and audit the nonprofit, the first thing I'm gonna do is wear your minutes. Wear your minutes and guiding the staff making that decision, purchase, hiring, fixing, all that is a board decision that should be documented in writing. But most of the time, we don't even document the process. So you should document your process as an organization. It should be clear that you're carrying out the role. I'm dealing with a municipality right now, and they have no vision. I was telling you a little bit about that. They have no vision. So now, every time they make a decision about money, the first thing that I say is, why? Yeah. Why are you making that decision? First of all, what problem are you trying to resolve as a nonprofit? Because we're all in the service business. Even government, in a sense, is a nonprofit, even though it has its own rules. Because most of the people that get in that position are elected. Then there are appointed people like myself that were career appointees. So we're still public service nonetheless, and we have rules that we should have written. The other thing is code of conduct. If you're going to have integrity, if you're going to institute integrity, you've got to write code of conduct. As a matter of fact, before I give an award, even the state DOT that is under my jurisdiction, because I fund most of their program on the non-construction side, it says before they dole out any money, they have a written code of conduct. Why is that? Why do you think that is?
It checks and balances.
Checks and balances for what reason?
On money and a budget.
So that there is not conflict of interest. And that is where integrity falls. Before I write down my internal controls, I better be integrity minded. Integrity requires one thing, and that's a commitment to the vision. Stan talked about morality and excellence. When you marry those two together, you're going to have integrity. Because the other thing that's going to fall from that is a commitment to those two other things. One of the things I tell our leadership often is, we are all bipolar. In this mess, think about this. When you had that job, right, and anybody that has kids, the first thing you do is you wake up and you get your kids ready, and because in society you have to go to school at a certain age, between this age and that age, we teach them to do their best when they get on the school bus or walk to school, right? Then we go to the job and we have this negative disposition about the job, right? That's what I'm saying, bipolar. We go to work and we're like, oh, I'm here with John. I'm here with Calvin. And so what happens is we're spending our energy on the negative part and not on what we do for our own children. Anybody that has a child, you're motivating your child every day that you send them to school or any kind of social setting to either act their best or do their best. And then you turn around, you go to work, and even because it's a common experience, you know what you're going to be facing, you still have a negative disposition most of the time. So you're spending your energy on that negativeness. And what ends up happening is you turn out bad practices. So what you got to do is you got to break that and do what you naturally do for your children. You go, you take your daughter or your son, and you motivate them to do their best when they go to school. That's the integrity that I'm talking about that needs to be common when you go to work. That's why internal controls, when you write down your process and your procedures, you make sure that it documents the board's policies and procedures, the employees, and the volunteers, and that common integrity goes right through all three groups. That's why it benefits the whole organization. And so what happens in that framework, Stan talked about the separateness of objectives, those are actually three separate entities within this one organization called Woodbury Child Development Center. They're actually separate things. One is the board. The board is responsible for the health and well-being of the organization, the health and well-being of its volunteers, the health and well-being of its employees. Right? The executive director is responsible for making sure the health and welfare of the organization goes from day to day. So one has a vision out, we're on a ship, the board is, you know, taking shifts, steering the ship. No, I'm sorry. Looking through the binoculars, and the executor sometimes gets some rest, but most of the time is at the wheel. And our hope is that we're feeding the energy. So we try to make that simple by writing down the process. So what are the things that need to be included in your internal controls? Your accounting, your computer security, conflict of interest issues. Now, conflict of interest issues is this. For both the board should be clear about their role to the organization, and then the organization employees should know their conflicts to the organization as well. Volunteers, because they're not paid, can't really pose a conflict, with the exception of one instance. There are federal awards that can be made where you can take all of our time and use that as a match to a federal award. That's where the conflict comes in. When there's value placed on somebody's time and it's a part of the award itself to do that work. So those things should be written. Personnel information should be written. Purchasing should be written. Your records retention, just like we have personal filings, everybody here that has done their filing for IRS, receipts, records of accomplishment. If federal or state money is involved, there's something called retention of records. That's a law. That's required that you retain either information or let's say that you received a federal award in this organization, even state. You're required to tag a piece of equipment or a supply because it came from that source. And you're supposed to maintain that until it no longer has value for the mission in which you were using that piece of equipment. And then lastly, travel. Now, the way that things should be working is there's three things in a budget from any kind of corporate level. And they have different terminology, but they're three essential in both for-profit and non-profit. Direct cost, direct non-labor costs, and what is called indirect cost. They're in everything in the United States. Governments, universities, non-profits. In the for-profit world, it's called overhead. And then for-profits are allowed profit, a profit line item. There should be written board-approved delegation of authority for documentation. So when the board is not in session, does it have an executive committee? If it doesn't have an executive committee, is it vesting in the executive or the highest person to make decisions when they're not in session? Should be written. An annual board-approved operating budget, broken down in those three categories I talked about. Responsibility of government filing for grant reporting vested in a staff member with knowledge of the requirements. There's a lot, but essentially what I'm saying is this. If I gave an award, I wrote a check right now, and I say on that check, this fund will only be for multimedia. It is, the executive director is going to be responsible to make sure it's called restricted funds and it goes to multimedia. And then the reporting is her responsibility as well. Bank statements opened and reviewed. Now I did about 2 years ago, I did a webinar, national webinar with an accounting firm and it was preventing waste, fraud, and abuse. And one of the problems, major problems with a nonprofit, one of the most significant problems in waste, fraud, and abuse, is organizations make the mistake to vest all the power in one person. I'm just using you as an example. So what would happen is a check would come in the mail, and if there was no checks and balances or written procedures as you were talking about, this person would open the check and write it. Now, waste, fraud, and abuse in this country, from the federal government perspective, does not get detected for about a year and a half. So people are spending money illegally. And so one of the major findings in an audit you will find is there's no separation of duties. We invest in the executive director because that person has talent, the know-how, is, you know, wonderful person, excellent relationships, but does not have separation of duties. And so if the board doesn't understand that, they're going to be in trouble. And it's going to have what's called a latent condition that will impose on the organization. So you should have separation of duties. That means there should be one person, there should be a clerk under your stewardship that should be opening up the mail and the bank statements. Anything that has anything to do with money should be separated from the executive and checked and logged by some other staff member. There should be an annual review or audit. Now, I'm almost done.
It's okay.
When people see here the term audit, they think of this very formal procedure. But in this country, under our IRS rules, you're not required to have an official audit if you're not receiving a whole lot of money. What you are supposed to do is have what's called a 990. And that eventually will be made available on this website that for nonprofits. So once you do it and conduct it, it's a very simple thing. A CPA, you could probably do it. A financial review, making sure that the three categories are met, the restricted and unrestricted funds are met, you know, meeting the condition, and that there's what's called source documentation and that those conditions were met. All of that should be on file. And then lastly, financial information supplied to the board at least quarterly. Board structure provides a finance committee or treasurer who is responsible for overseeing the organization's financial management and informing the full board of any issues that arise. And that's quarterly. So we have an accountant. We have a past treasurer.
I'm still the treasurer.
You're still the treasurer. Okay, you're the current treasurer. What should be happening is the board should be making sure these activities are pushed out, and I just gave you the interval. So on the quarter, we should know the status of all funds, both restricted, unrestricted, both direct, direct non-labor, purchases, your purchases for telephone, any contracts that you have, any money that you're sending out the door for services. And then you should know what your indirect costs, utilities, paper, printer refiller, what all those are indirect costs. Because what happens in an organization is usually there's multiple sources of funds. And so what an indirect cost is usually a rate for, let's say, the utilities to keep the lights on in this building. And then you take this rate and you break it down into what are called pools or F&A pools. And then you apply that rate to all the different grant awards that are coming from the sources. It's called consistency, and consistently apply. So these are kind of things that the board is responsible for. I'll leave you with this story. The audit that FBI and the Inspector General experience that I went through, it wasn't the first, but the most significant one that I was sort of interviewed for, both, I was indirectly by the FBI, but directly by the Inspector General. I had to sit down and talk to somebody. But the organization, essentially the board, had this laissez-faire attitude to this gentleman that had been the executive director for over 20 years. And what happened was because of that, over time, they were signing without reading, literally, his increases. Now, he didn't really make that much money in the industry, but for where this organization was, it was in the bottom of South Jersey, he went from $79,000 to $125,000. $125,000 is not that much for over 20 years experience. They got into a tiff in one of their meetings, and they ended up firing the executive director. But just the proceedings of the organization started making the newspaper because they always had a reporter at their meetings. The FBI went in and did an examination, seized all the records of the organization and the individual to make sure that there was no malfeasance on his part. What they did find was mismanagement. No federal offense was found. My point of saying that is this. It's responsible for why these things need to be documented. Why on the financial side, as well as the performance side. All of these organizations, whether it's the federal government, the state government, even a nonprofit, these nonprofits that have money like Pew Foundation, they're going to want the same thing. So you want to make sure that your board has these documents and procedures written down, and the function and roles for the people that are going to be engaged, whether it's for a salary or volunteer-wise. Lastly, I'll say this. The vision is critical. Because what ends up happening when a board has a vision, and the board, every single solitary member is committed to that vision, we are all going to be in one mind.
And the question will become, we'll always ask that question, why are we spending money on this? Why are we doing that? Why do we want to have Pat versus Calvin versus Stan? One of the things that's happened in government, and I'm going to sit down after this, my organization has a national, what's called strategic implementation plan. That's drilled down to me in a what's called a unit plan inside of the state of New Jersey. And then my unit, I have five disciplines that I'm over. I have a what's called a subject matter experts over all five of those units. We have a subunit to that. And then my performance plan is tied to my subunit. And that subunit to the office, and then the office to the national. The reason why they tied that up is because now they're saying, we want your performance to be towards the objective of the national organization, forget about being the state. And so every decision I make is driven about whether I'm meeting my unit goal. And every evaluation I do for my employees, are they meeting their unit goal of this subunit? Are they the subject matter expert over that unit, and are they performing to the capacity of which I know their talent? I tell people I'm not a manager alone, I'm a talent manager. I have people that are highly expert in what they do. And so I have to manage that talent. The key when you talk to people at that level is that you'll always keep the integrity up above. And they will always perform for you.
Hey, Sam. There's a lot in one day, in a few hours, but the purpose of this meeting is to kind of set the stage for the future.
Yes.
So we have these sessions once a month for the next 2 months, or it's three, and then we'll do them quarterly. Now, ultimately, we expect this to grow and grow and grow to the point where Woodbury Child Development Center is now the thrust for the whole community, City of Woodbury and beyond, right? Now, what does that mean? That means perhaps a year from now, rather than doing monthly or quarterly sessions, we have full-day conferences where we're promoting excellence morality as a curriculum to anybody that wants to participate in what we're doing. That's how I think. Ms. Brady writes a book on it, maybe Calvin and Ron write a book or two on it. But the idea is we're taking the responsibility. And that's how I look at it. I'm responsible for how I impact you. And I don't really play with that because I answer to a high power. I don't play with that. I like having fun, but I really don't play with that. So that's why they're here. That's why a lot of you are here. If we move this thing forward, we are going to be in that kind of position. And I will tell you, there are local governments and businesses that will jump on board because they know what we mean to solving a lot of issues, but also bringing up a lot of opportunities. And that's where the WCDC Life comes in. If we're willing to learn and accept this forever, we'll have excellence. And it'll include everybody from newborn all the way up. Never stop learning. That's it for me. We do have a presentation. Competition, I gotta stay ahead of them. I know how you are.
Okay, first I talked a little bit earlier about Avenues Independently and our collaboration with the Woodbury Child Development Center. So I want to introduce my board. We have two of our members here today. A few other members are out of town, and so they couldn't be with us. But the members of our board, Marvin Clark, come on guys, let's go. And this is Kelly Gallagher. And we are missing two board members, and I want to recognize them. Rich DeFreitas from PM Source, and Candace Kennedy, who is a teacher at Holy Angels School. So Woodbury Child Development, we've been, in case any of you don't know, we've been raising money for the last 2 years for Lori. And we've been raising money to put new roofs on our building. So we don't really have roof patches, we have new roofs. There are 5 roofs at the Woodbury Child Development, all in desperate need of repair, not really repair, replacement. So the first roof was replaced about a year ago. That was our kitchen roof. Then we have a center main roof, and we replaced that in, what month did we do that?
November.
There were still some problems with some leaking going on, and I spoke with the board members of Avenues at the end of the year. We could have donated some money, or we could have given it to the federal government. So I decided I kind of like these guys, and I asked my board if it would be okay. I like the Woodbury Child Development. I want to help the children, and what we wanted to do was to make sure that the roof repairs that were done, some inside repairs were going to be done, and I didn't want the old roof to leak into the new things, and I thought that there were, so the third roof was done in December, at the end of December, and Avenues to Independent Living donated $20,000 to the Woodbury Child Development. Giant check, the big check.
There you go.
Okay. I messed up a little bit. This is Kelly Gallagher. She is our board member. Morgan Clark is another board member. And we are presenting this $20,000 to the Woodbury Child Development for their roof. And we really now have only 2 roofs left. And we probably need about $20,000 to complete the work. And we are going to continue to work on that roof, those 2 roofs being replaced for the next year. Even though I'm not going to be on the board, I still want to be an integral part of it, and replacing those 2 roofs is one of the things that I would really like to help with. So, there we go. Wall at the Woodbury Child Development, and hopefully other organizations, other companies can really get on board, because $20,000, we've raised $65,000. Mm-hmm. So another $20,000 is just a pittance. But I'll tell you, for a long time, people would say to me, you'll never raise the money, you'll never get those roofs. Never's not a word I like to hear. And so I hope that everybody who joins the board will take my enthusiasm, bother people, talk to them, really spread the word that what a valuable organization and our children are. So thank you.
Thank you.
Everybody. Dana's a photographer doing pictures. Carlton's doing video.
Hi,
time is
checking.
I don't know what you need to do. People in the community, blah, 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 blah. so that we get total buy-in. So use this experience as an opportunity to promote, to get people into this thing at whatever level, because the more they get exposed to what we're doing here, the better we are. I'll indicate one mind. We can make that happen very easily. When you talk about 4 months, 4 month-old baby, I think that'll work. So let them know that what we're trying to do is that significant and what I would say advancing society. I'd like to talk about that. All right.
I'll call you so you have my number.
And then
but
you
can't get it.
Oh, yeah. Oh, you're going to make a separate list.
Yeah.
Oh, I thought you were
going to
get
a list. Oh, this was the main area. Oh, okay. All right, so here's what I'm going to do. The list of all the subcommittees I need to hear. So just put your name and which subcommittee you'd like to be on.
I
don't
like to stop. So this is contract.
Want to look at Monday? I really enjoy listening to you, and he was so amazing.